I would like to talk to you about what makes a good theory and how do we make a theory good. Before we get stuck in, I'd like to give an overview as to why I think this is important, a tiny bit on how I see the difference between framework and theory. Define what I call metatheoretical calculi, because I think they are necessary but not sufficient to having good theories. And then jump in to my criteria for theoretical goodness and how these could be used, or how maybe these are already used. Right, so why? I think theories are essentially the goal of science, and empirical evidence is used to support, test, improve, demolish our theories. And what we do is reason about what empirical evidence might mean for our theories. That's one thing that we do in science. And the way that we do it is quite often by using formal or computational or both models, different types of models essentially, to mediate between the theory and the empirical evidence. And these are all sort of separate activities, but I think they kind of go together in order to improve our theories and give us good theories. This is necessary, but is it sufficient for good theories? You want to know more about the things I just mentioned, please take a look at this paper, How Computational Modeling Can Force Theory Building in Psychological Science. So like I said, I just want to say one or two points about the difference between theory and framework. So for me, a theory, when I say that word, what I mean is a scientific proposition described by a collection of natural language sentences, mathematics, logic, and figures that introduces causal relations with the aim of describing, explaining, and or predicting a set of phenomena. And that's different to a framework, because I think a framework is sort of what the theory is embedded in. And within a framework, there can be many theories because they'll share some important assumptions about the world. Like, for example, there are many theories of human working memory. So when scientists talk to each other, what we do is quite often talk about our theories and we reason about them and we mediate, like I said, between our theories, the empirical evidence that exists, and we do that using computational formal models. Essentially, what we do is we adjudicate over them. So we say things like, I don't know, my theory is better than yours, or this is a very appropriate theory for understanding such and such. And if we formalize this, so if we put it in a formal logic setting, for example, I call that a metatheoretical calculus. So what I mean by that is a metatheoretical calculus is the formalization of this adjudication over theory. So a kind of reasoning that we do, meta-theoretical, meta-scientific reasoning, can be understood this way. And I've done that in cognitive computational neuroscience, where I looked at how we reason there, but I also think this is possible to be done within any science. And if you want to read more about that, please take a look at Onological Inference Over Brains Behavior and Artificial Neural Networks with my co-author, Andrea Martin. But like I said, I don't think this is enough. I think it's very important. I think it's necessary, but it's not enough, I think. I think there's more that we do or could do. I also think there's like history and genealogy of theories and ideas in science or fields in general that can deserve scrutiny, or that does deserve scrutiny. Like, for example, here is eugenics, which used to be seen as scientific, now is seen as pseudoscientific, but unfortunately could still rear its ugly head in many situations. It's a science or an ex-science. I think it's a pseudoscience, but it has the trappings of a science and was used by scientists. And sometimes still is, unfortunately. And this is an image from eugenicists. And it's very obvious that they wanted their field to touch every other field, infect every other field, and we have to live with that legacy. So I think for something to be good, we need to check that it's always been good in a critical way and understand how it might have less good elements. What about theories that don't dissolve great man theory? So shouldn't we want to stop that from happening? I'm not sure we've really managed that in many ways. We still have people who are seen as founding fathers of fields, like Ronald Fisher for statistics, for example, is seen as one of, or the founding father. But I think it still continues to this day, where individual people, often men, are seen as taking credit for all of the work when we know that science is a team effort. What about checking that the rest of the field understands what we're on about? Sometimes you could just blind people by obfuscating important points using very fancy models. That doesn't seem good. And what about allowing new ideas or people in? If you don't do that, that doesn't seem good to me, but it does seem to be the case that it happens. So we should probably act to change that and indeed allow new ideas and people in. We shouldn't have theories that are hostile to diversity and giving credit where credit is due and stopping plagiarism. Right, so now I'm gonna get stuck in and say what kind of criteria I think, or an ontology of criteria. So one aspect of goodness is meta-theoretical. So looking at the metaphysical commitments of a theory. So how is it embedded in its broader field? Is it explicitly embedded in its broader field? That is an aspect of how good the theory is, in my opinion. So is it clear that a theory is about, for example, artificial intelligence, or does it seem to also be about brains? So I think that should be something that theories make clear. This theory is only about evolution and not about human psychology, for example. Which beliefs within this theory are not under investigation? So for example, if a theoretician or a proponent of a theory has certain beliefs, these should be clarified in their manuscript or their writings in general. So if someone believes in computationalism, that should be clear that they believe that the brain is a computer in the formal sense. And they're not interested in empirical evidence to support that claim because they've taken it as an assumption for their theory. And which a theory should also state which beliefs are under investigation. So a completely different theory might actually want to investigate empirically if all the brain does is compute, for example. Another element of this, of goodness, theoretical goodness, is discourse. So does the theory survive scrutiny within the field it's embedded in? So is it understood? Is it understandable by interested people, non-bad actors? Or is it in some way elitist or only allowed to be understood by in-group people? Are words used transparently? So obviously, quite often scientists use words in technical ways, but that needs to be done in a clear way, especially if it's done in a way that's different to the rest of the field, then that should be signposted. And the same with concepts. So for example, biological plausibility might be something that makes sense in biology, but might not be used sensibly in psychology or neuroscience. And the same with even the names of subfields, like cognitive computational neuroscience is seen as a new field, computational cognitive neuroscience used to exist before that. And I'm not even sure if anyone has explicitly written that deeply, other than in this upcoming paper with Iris Van Rooy and Andrea Martin that I have. Has anyone really compared or contrasted or explained why two fields with very similar names exist? So these things should be clear in order to facilitate communication. Another aspect of goodness is counter evidence or evidence and how that interfaces with the theory. So a theory should be able to say which claims it makes are empirical, so they can enter potentially the sort of traditional scientific method, because The traditional scientific method, shown as a caricature here, is not applicable in all cases. So we need to know where you can enter this empirical data collection, for example. And how are these claims tested? There's many options, there's many different ways of testing claims. And that should be transparent and clear. How do our findings affect the theory? Some findings are seen to be often ignored, and other findings require the theory to change. So these things should be clarified, that if a finding goes this way, indeed we have to accommodate it in our theory, for example, like comparing and contrasting biological and artificial neurons can be seen as an empirical question and not a metaphysical commitment. Unfortunately, I need to talk about something which I've already touched on, which is that scientific theories have done have contributed to or even driven crimes against humanity. So we need to care about that. For a theory to be good, it has to not do harm. And the way I think that can be done, or one way, is that the history of the theory should be properly documented, and the contributions by people should be also properly documented, so people both can take credit and blame in a transparent and fair way. So here is an example where Ada Lovelace is seen to have defined the field of computer science in the 1840s before it existed. So she's credited as being the first programmer. I think she should also be credited as being the creator of modern computer science. The science of operations, as derived from mathematics, more especially, is a science of itself and has its own abstract truth and value. I would say that's a proposal for a new science, and we call it computer science. She called it the science of operations. We also need to have theories that don't promote personality cults. So this is a figure where each dot represents an individual scientist. I think all or almost all are men, and they're held to sort of define people in areas. But the thing is, if you only have this frame where you see it as people being the unit of science and not theories or papers being the unit of science, you really exacerbate personality cults, or at least great man theory. We also need to refer to our ancestors and our other fellow humans. So ancient and non-Western cultures need to be included when we talk about our theories, history, or our theories in the present, where we have people contributing to them from outside the global north. This figure shows manuscript in Islamic science and describing the relationship between the eyeball and the brain. Our theories also need to acknowledge and admit even to their contribution to injustice or their uses to carry out crimes against humanity or lesser bad things, but still very bad things. We need to acknowledge the very bad things that science has done in order for us to ever have a chance of claiming that we're good, or that our theories are good, or that our main product is good. And if it has byproducts that are bad, that's a sign. And this is another example of that. So modern machine learning and artificial intelligence has sort of rejuvenated and automated long discredited pseudosciences like physiognomy. And all of this is sort of part and parcel, or implied, or under the umbrella of decolonizing ourselves. So this is an example of a machine learning algorithm where the first column, so the leftmost column, is the ground truth. The middle column is we added blur to my co-author's face, and then we put it through a depixelizer deblurring algorithm. So an algorithm that attempts to like reconstruct what it thinks the input was. And what you see is that her face is sort of masculinized and whitened. If this is the sort of way that this model works, it shows that if we use this model as a model of the brain, or if we use this model in any other applied situation, there's a problem, and it is a serious problem that we need to deal with, because it is either a product or a byproduct of our scientific work with, in this case, neural networks or models of vision. So to slightly zoom out a bit, what we need to do, in my opinion, is iterate over and augment this checklist. So I don't think that what I just presented is the full picture. And I also don't think that it ever ends. You never stop sort of criticizing or improving your theory from any angle, including what I just described as goodness. And I think it's our duty to question our foundations, the foundations on which we build our theories, the frameworks on which we build our theories, and the whole structure of science. So the byproducts, products of our theories, how our theories are used, if society benefits from them, and so on. And this is every scientist's responsibility. So if you work in a field and that field is used to enact eugenics in 2022, that's your responsibility. Even if it's not uniquely yours, you are a scientist in that area, and we are extremely privileged. So we have a duty. So yeah, thank you. And I'd love to hear your thoughts.